Venezuela. Actually, I did work for the entire 8 years for the Reagan administration. and for improvement in human rights. As Charles Suarez mentioned, the human rights, the repression has increased in the last 2 years. The number of people fleeing the country has once again increased. The reforms that have been touted, the so-called reforms, are reforms that can be reversed and have been, in fact, lately have been reversed by the government of Cuba because they want more money and more concessions from the United States. Venezuela, very quickly. Venezuela, as I said, I'm an ambassador to Venezuela for 1989, one of the wealthiest countries in Latin America. In fact, they're more important than the highest per capita income in Latin America. It has, if you include the heavy crudes, it has the largest reserves of oil in the world, even larger than Saudi Arabia. It has every kind of mineral and natural resource you can think of, bauxite, gold, natural gas, the second largest reserve for natural gas in the Western Hemisphere. And yet, the government of first Hugo Chavez and now Nicolas Maduro have managed to bankrupt that country to the point that there are food riots in many, many towns. You don't see them on the news because Western press very seldom ventures outside of Caracas, outside of the capital city. Even there you see, occasionally you see these riots, food riots, and you do hear reports, unfortunately, of babies dying for lack of medicine, people throwing themselves off windows of hospitals because medicines are in such short supply and they are in such pain, literally. This is the result of the kind of policies that were established in Venezuela. For those who say, well, the policy of, quote, isolating after being for 50 years didn't work, so it had to be changed. Well, again, when Ronald Reagan came into office in 1981, he also concluded that the policy of isolating, or let's say containing Soviet Union, had to work and it had to be changed. But the difference between the Reagan policy and the Obama policy is that Reagan decided that he was going to change the policy to one that would result in the liberation of the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc. And as a result, peacefully, hundreds of millions of people from Eastern Europe to Asia were liberated from the yoke of communism. So many years later, it took time, but it was a strategy. This is not, unfortunately, what is happening in any one of the foreign policy initiatives of the Obama administration. If you look at the world as it is today versus what it was 8 years ago, almost 8 years ago, when President Obama took office, the United States cannot point to a single foreign policy success. You know, Iran, in 2009, the first year, Obama turns back on the Green Revolution. The Iranians went out in the streets, they asked the United States to support. Obama just did absolutely nothing, so the Ayatollahs cracked down, and we know the result. The regime is not only still there, but stronger. In fact, stronger because the Obama administration negotiated what I consider a very flawed treaty that gave the Iranian dictatorship $150 billion, and in the opinion of a lot of experts in the nuclear field, a green light to build a nuclear bomb. We could go on the Syria, the famous Syria red line in the sand that Obama drew, and then completely ignored, and he said, well, you know, I didn't draw the line, and it was clear that he had said Egypt, we undermined the Mubarak authoritarian dictatorship, no question that it was authoritarian, but then opened the door to the Muslim Brotherhood, which was in the process of establishing a totalitarian dictatorship, very much like what happened with President Carter and the Shah of Iran, and the undermining of the Shah and stop there and open up the questions if we have time. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Of prosperity.